All right, so Michael from C3, what can you tell me about C3, man?
We're a communications firm based in Chicago that helps nonprofits use the web effectively with web development, video, and online engagement and outreach.
I know for a lot of nonprofits we talk to, one of the barriers for entry is, you know, we don't have the money to do it. Or, you know, we can't do it effectively. We don't have huge budgets, so we're not even going to get into it.
Right.
Does it have to be expensive to do video? And if not, what are some examples?
It doesn't have to be expensive, but it's really about the culture of your organization. You know, I mean, think about the web. You know, if you went to a nonprofit in 1995 and you said, you know, do you need a website? Well, they would start to say, well, maybe we do. And if you told them that they were going to have a whole web department that they were going to spend money on, they would think you were crazy. Where's the money going to come from? Well, now everybody has that. So I think video is moving in that direction. But it's also about the culture of the organization. What kind of talent do you hire? You know, what kind of people do you hire inside your organization? So the organizations that are doing video really well, like a Charity Water or those kind of groups, have video built into the DNA. It's really, you know, from the very beginning, they're thinking about, you know, what kind of resources they're going to have in terms of staff to be able to show what they do, which is what people are demanding. You know, everybody now is talking about this Kony video from Invisible Children, and they often forget to mention that these guys have spent almost 10 years essentially building a massive grassroots organization of youth around the country. So when they have something ready to go, people jump on it. But that, you know, they won $1 million from Chase Bank because they were able to mobilize this.
They won that award.
Yeah, they won because they were able to mobilize their constituents. But it took years to build that constituency and activities and fun and connecting and online and offline, and you know, so there's lots behind. It's 10 years later, they're an overnight success.
Exactly, yeah. Right.
And I think the key learning there that organizations have, that fundraisers have known forever, is you have to make your donor your hero, your participant your hero. So it's not about Kony. The Kony video is not about Kony. It's about you, the viewer, and I want to be part of this group. Look at these people. They're having fun. They're standing there holding signs. They're going to put posters up. You get to wear a bracelet, you know. And so it becomes really a story about how you can be the hero in this story, right, which is changing the world.
It's from like a documentary narrative. Weren't so many of the things even somewhat cliche of like talking with this kid and what's the future we're leaving to my
right.
child and
right.
all these like heartstrings, but they've been played so
well,
much. Did these things ever go out of style, or are they ever
going
to become?
It's a good point. I mean, I think the truth is, I think most of us who work in this world see things over and over again, and then we go, oh, it's cliche. But for the most people in the world, no, that stuff works, and it works, you know, over and over again. So, but what it did really well was something that this guy at Harvard, Marshall Ganz, really pioneered, this idea of three stories that you tell. The first one is the story of self. So it's saying, here's who I am, right? And that's what the Kony video does with our protagonist, which is not a Ugandan, it's an American. And he says, here's who I am. And then the story of us, which is the story of the coming together of people around this issue. So he tells the story of Invisible Children and how it came together. And then the third is the story of now, and that is why right now we have to do something. And they make the case, and they even name the whole campaign 2012, right? It's all about now. So they did all of those pieces perfectly, and that's really rules for activists. You have to tell a personal story that connects with people. Then you have to tell a story that connects your story to everybody else's story, right? The story that we're connecting to isn't the Ugandan story. It's the story of me on the computer, on Facebook, connecting with this organization. That's the story they're telling. And then the third one is, why do I have to do something today, now? And they did all of that really well. And on top of that, you have a clear good guy, bad guy story. You know, there's this one guy, and he's a bad guy. You can't get simpler than that.
Well,
so on that level, I think every organization can think about that. What's our story of self and story of us and story of now? And how do we mobilize people through that? I think that's really the takeaway. Unfortunately, I'm sure for many organizations, the takeaway is going to be, hey, we got to go out and make a half an hour video.
Right, right, yeah, the gross oversimplification.
And we've seen many times large organizations have gotten views, hundreds of thousands of views, even millions of views, having no impact on their web traffic or donations, because most of those views are happening on YouTube. And the most likely thing that someone will do after watching a video on YouTube is watch another video on YouTube, which is not what an organization wants them to do. And that's why you need tools that help people take the video, the videos and actually,
I haven't really ever considered this.
You know, turn it into action.
Turn it into action. Yeah, yeah.
You have to have a call to action. And it's not easy to do in the tools like YouTube.
Now, what are some tools? I mean, aside from the self-sufficing, but what other types of tools or different things are like calls to action have you seen tied to a video that actually do drag people from viewers to engaged?
Right.
What have you
seen? I think we have to think about it as a cycle, you know, that it's not like somebody's never heard of you before and they see something and they're so moved that they donate or they give action. That happens sometimes, but it's not all the time. Usually you have an awareness phase. Oh, I heard about that issue, and then I heard about it again. And now I'm presented with a way to do something about it. But then you have a whole back end that organizations work on of things like thanking and stewardship, which is absolutely key to keeping people involved. I mean, there's probably a lot of people who are going to get this Kony packet that they're going to get with, you know, the bracelet and the whatever, and they're going to, who knows what they're going to do with it. And if there's no follow-up on the back end, you're really not taking advantage of that relationship with that constituent. Video can do that too, you know, so you can have calls to action. Well, one way is to introduce people and deepen their engagement. So it says, you just took this action, you just got this box from us, but here's 10 things you didn't know about the situation in Uganda. I think that would be a great outcome of the Kony situation, would be that a lot of people who don't know anything but what's in that video, who are somewhat misinformed maybe by some of the things in the video, decide to dig deeper from that experience. So they'll learn from it and they'll seek out the information. And ideally, the organization itself is the one giving those folks the next thing to watch.
Oh, you are so damn good at this stuff. It's inspiring. It's like watching Stevie Ray Vaughan play guitar. This was really good.
Seriously.
Yeah, that was amazing.
Wow. That was awesome. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.